Thanks very much, Igor. It's great to be here. Thank you all for giving up your lunch or whatever you're doing. That's pretty real. Be careful with this one. All right. Yes, so this is the title of my talk, Regenerative Medicine, Capability and Impact. And I guess because you folks are predominantly medical students, it would be appropriate for me to start by telling you what I'm going to try to save you from today. So, I occasionally have the challenge of giving talks to practicing doctors. And it's very difficult, because I'll give a talk about medicine of the future, and their eyes will all glaze over, and at the end of the talk they'll say, okay, so what can I prescribe? So it's fairly obvious that they haven't even been listening, but also it's obvious that they're not really got the priorities straight. I think it's extraordinarily important, not just for medical students, but also for practicing doctors, to have as much current knowledge as they possibly can about what medicine is going to happen in the future, especially the broad themes of what type of medicine is going to happen in the future, for a whole bunch of reasons. First of all, just as preparation for being able to deliver those medicines when they arrive, but also in terms of actual just interaction with your patients, just getting them to understand what their options have some chance of being at some time in the future. And of course, a lot of people recoil from that sort of logic. They'll think, well, okay, it's speculative, especially in terms of the time frames, therefore it's really not something to prioritize. But I think that's very short-sighted. I think that it definitely does more harm than good to restrict one's focus as a medic to only medicines that already exist. So today's talk is very much going to be about medicines that do not already exist. Of course, the general field of regenerative medicine is something that is in the process of coming into existence very much. It's very fashionable right now, lots and lots of very important stuff going on, including stuff that's in clinical trials and one or two things that are already approved. But it's going to be a very big deal indeed. And what I'm going to be telling you about is why it's going to be a particularly big deal for the most prevalent diseases and conditions that medics have to contend with at the moment, which are, of course, the conditions associated with old age. Okay, so I thought I'd just start very briefly by saying a little bit about my foundation. We're a charity. We're a US-registered charity, even though I'm originally British. And we're interested in pretty much what I just said, the development of regenerative medicine solutions to the problems of aging. We have an in-house laboratory in Sunnyvale in the Bay Area in San Francisco, but we probably two-thirds or more of our money goes on extramural research in universities around the world. And of course, we do outreach. We do a lot of outreach. I do the most completely brutal amount of media, and also I give probably roughly one invited talk a week. I spend my entire time on the road, and it's absolutely punishing, but it's worth it because getting the word out is a really essential part of making all this happen. So I'm not going to talk much about why this is a worthwhile thing to do, because I think most people in this room probably get this. But this is basically the purpose. I mean, a lot of people think, well, okay, aging, that's a good thing to die of. They'll think, what we don't want to die of is like cancer and cardiovascular disease and such like. And what we'd like to do is have a nice, like, good death from natural causes. Well, I say that's complete bollocks. But partly because, these things are linked, obviously. Age-related diseases are age-related for a reason, namely that they are aspects of the later stages of aging. So if we were to combat aging, we would be taking the fast track to really combating the age-related diseases that we definitely don't want to die of. But also, the fact is, it's not much fun dying of natural causes either, as is illustrated here. And so my plan is to stop either of these things from happening. And today I'm going to talk about how. I'm going to start by giving a very 30,000-foot view, probably rather irritatingly abstract and theoretical treatment of why I have begun to focus on regenerative medicine as the general approach to combating aging that I feel has the greatest promise. Then I'm going to start talking about some real biology. I'm going to get into breaking down the regenerative medicine approach to combating aging into its various components. I'm going to be explaining why I think that it can be usefully broken down into 7 components. Then, as you will already have seen by that time, I will be running out of time. I will not be able to talk by any means in any detail about all 7 of those components, so I shall restrict myself to talking about one of them in considerably more detail, just to reassure you that this is real science and not just hand-waving. And then, in the last probably third or quarter of the talk, what I'm going to do is look at the longer term. And I'm going to shift at that point from talking about basic biology and biotechnology to talking about the history of technology, talking about what we can guess, what we can predict, probabilistically of course, about what will be likely to occur in terms of the rate of subsequent progress after we make initial breakthroughs that I was talked about before that time, and what that well, what impact that will have on how long people can stay healthy and therefore on how long people can stay alive. And right at the end, I'm going to say a few words about how you can make a difference. All right, so I'm going to start here. Now, as with any hard technical challenge, the essential first step in figuring out how to meet that challenge, how to solve the technical problem, is to state the problem in a particular way. If you state the problem in a way that is correct but distracting, then you'll actually slow yourself down in terms of trying to solve the problem. So I have spent some time coming to a really good, really useful, functionally useful definition of aging, and this is it. I'm saying two things here. First of all, I'm saying something pretty obvious. Metabolism causes pathology. You all knew that. Aging is a side effect of being alive in the first place. The reason why we get problems in old age is because of things that have accumulated throughout life. But the second thing I'm saying here, which is the one I really want to make sure that you focus on, but it's going to be essential to understanding the rest of the talk, is this concept of damage. I'm going to be using this word damage in a very, very specific way for this talk. I'm going to be using it to denote the intermediate between metabolism and pathology. In other words, the side effects, the molecular and cellular side effects that are caused as immediate side effects of metabolism throughout life, even starting before we're born, and that accumulate. So that eventually, when they have accumulated sufficient abundance, they start to get in the way of metabolism and pathology starts to emerge. Of course, I'm using the word pathology in a rather broad sense here to denote all of the various things that go wrong with us in old age, whether they be things that we actually give names to or whether they be simple aspects of frailty. And similarly, I'm using the word metabolism not merely to mean oxidative metabolism, as in the phrase metabolic rate, but to mean everything that goes on in our bodies, the entire network of molecular and cellular and systemic processes that keep us alive. So why is that such a useful definition? Well, basically, this is why. I've got here metabolism causing damage, causing pathology. And the reason this is a useful definition is because we can then describe and distinguish between the two major themes that have existed in thinking so far, in historical thinking, with regard to how we might postpone aging. And I'm going to call those the gerontology approach and the geriatrics approach. So the geriatric approach is essentially, let's focus on old people. Let's try and slow down. I'm using obviously this notation from the genetic literature, these flat-headed arrows. Let's try and inhibit the process by which damage creates pathology. Let's try and identify people in whom pathology is beginning to emerge, and then try and, if you like, hold back the sands of time and stop the pathology from progressing at the rate that it naturally would. So if you can do that, of course, then you're going to be able to postpone the age at which the pathology reaches a stage that's really bad for health and really life-threatening. Now, the gerontology approach essentially says, well, maybe, prevention is better than cure, and we would actually have a better bet at postponing aging if we tried to intervene earlier on in the chain of events and inhibit this process instead, the process by which metabolism creates these various types of molecular and cellular damage in the first place. If we can clean up metabolism in that way, then obviously we have the same effect. We postpone the age at which damage reaches a pathogenic level. So these two approaches both look pretty promising at first sight. But of course, this, as you don't need to be a medic to know, is the problem with the geriatrics approach. Quite a lot goes wrong in old people. These things go wrong more or less simultaneously. They exacerbate each other. It's all absolutely chaotic and ghastly and miserable. And of course, even worse than that is the fact that it really is intervening too late in the chain of events. What's happening here is that the geriatrician is trying to target things whose precursors are accumulating. Remember, I've defined damage as the set of ongoing immediate byproducts of metabolism, which are accumulating throughout life, and they cause these pathologies. So the geriatrician's job is, in principle, getting progressively harder as the individual they're trying to treat gets progressively older. And that imposes a sort of vicious cycle, a downward spiral, such that the geriatrician's approach to combating aging, the medical approach, if you like, to aging today, is better than nothing, yes, but it's not much better than nothing, and it never, ever can be, much better than nothing. It's just going to be defeated by this downward spiral of accumulating damage. So that leaves us with the gerontology approach, but of course the gerontology approach doesn't look too hot either. because, as I'm sure you're all aware, metabolism is rather complicated. This is a simplified diagram of a small subset of what we know about how metabolism works, and it's bad enough, as you can see. But the real problem is, of course, that this is a simplified diagram of a small subset of what we know about how metabolism works, which is completely dwarfed by the utterly astronomical amount that we don't know, even leaving aside all the probably even more astronomical amount that we don't even know that we don't.